server, send this to the client. Maybe send in some sort of what we call K plus one to K. J plus one to K, of the bits, and then the client have to stop this. And then return to the server. Server will then compare that the result from client with what they pass to the client. Is it from the original password? If yes, then we say that communication is accepted. Of course, in this one we have the sub puzzle. So same thing, the server will send some of it, and then the client will have to solve and then send back. So now that is in the client puzzle situation. So now in this example, what we are supposed to compute is that, assuming that the client, the server, is possible to say that now instead of sending you only part of the puzzle, I send you the entire puzzle. The client say that I send you the entire puzzle, and then solve the puzzle. So now the client have to solve the entire puzzle. Same here, the client will have to solve the entire puzzle. So now if, let's say the client have to solve the entire puzzle, so we need to compute all together how many hashes the client have to perform. Because let's say the so-called puzzle, let's say maybe we call three bit puzzle. One puzzle K equal to 3. So it will become 0, 0, 0. It can be one possible puzzle. 0, 0, 1 can be one possible. 0, 1, 0, 0, 1, 1, 1, 0, 0, 1, 0, 1, 1, 1, 0, 1, 1, 1. So all together they are 8 possible pattern for this puzzle. To mean that if this puzzle is sent to the client, so the client, worst case scenario, need to perform only eight hash. It will get the answer. So meaning that the number of hashes need to be done equal to 8. If I have what we call eight puzzle, single puzzle with K equal to 3 bits. So because I have only one particular puzzle only, so whenever the puzzle sent, so that can be only one possible pattern that needs to seal. So meaning that if I say, I have this puzzle I sent over, so there is only one pattern that you need to solve. There's only one pattern that you need to solve. So now you have to count. If I have 8 expected hash, so altogether how many expected hash you have, frequency, how many times you do is 8, and then each one is one time and so forth. So you compute that. But if let's say I have a sub puzzle sent over, so let's say maybe I just take that we just take that the sub puzzle not as many as 8, we just take that we have three sub-puzzles, two sub-puzzles. Yeah. So if I have three sub-puzzles. Yeah. Three sub-puzzles. Each sub-puzzle is that is still 3-bit, 3-bit. So meaning that this one possible I need to do 8 hashes. Yeah? This one I need to do 8 hashes. This one I need to do 8 hashes because the data or the puzzle can be 0000. It can be 0000001. Yeah? It can be 0000010 possibly. Yeah? And many, many forms. It can be 0000001000 also possible. Yeah? So meaning that what we call the puzzle here, well now you need to do more hashes. Okay? So 8 times 3 is 24. So you need to do 24 hash to get the pattern that you want. Yeah? So now in these 24 hashes that we have to do, then again we have to see, oh, if let's say it is multiple puzzle. Okay? If let's say I have to do five hashes, because 24 hashes to find all possible combinations, right? So let's say we send in the pattern, then we say that the client have to do 5 hashes. Yeah? So in these 5 hashes, what are the possible pattern that the client can be, the server may send to the client. Okay? So then say, oh, 5 possible hashes. Then if I take this as a 3 sub-puzzle, then I will then say, oh, 5 possible hashes. So in order to get 5 possible hashes, it can be 1, 1, and 3. Yes? I hash this one time. I hash this one time. I hash this 3 times. Altogether, I do 5 hashes. Then I get the pattern. Yeah? It is also possible that the client have to hash this 1 time, 3 times, 1 time. Yes? Also 5 hashes. It is possible that 3 times, 1 time, 1 time, also 5 hashes. Yeah? It is also possible 1 time, 2 times, 2 times, also 5 hashes. You got me? Yeah, it can be 2 times, 2 times, 1 time, also 5 hashes. So now, how many possible patterns that form 5 hashes from these 3 puzzles? Right? So that is what we call the frequency. Yeah? So many of these puzzles, when we send over, so there are different frequency of possibilities. Yeah? So we see that these are the frequency distribution. Yeah, so now what you have to do is first identify how many expected types first. For each of these number of expected types, how many possible frequencies that can happen. So that is your frequency distribution for the types. That is part A. Yeah, later I'll show you how to compute this distribution. Yeah. For single puzzle is easy. Just now we said single puzzle, there can be only one pattern. There's no other way to solve this already. Yeah, there's only one puzzle, so you have to solve. Yeah, this one means this one. You don't have to see all 5 or can be 1, 1, 3 or 1, 3, 1 or whatever. Now it's only one, so we have to only solve that one. Yeah. So the number frequency will be increase in this sub-puzzle. Right. So that is question one. Now question two is actually 0.5 here. Okay. The hint here, later we can see we have formula. We do have formula to compute all the different patterns here. How many access and so on so forth. We do have formula to compute that. Yeah. But if let's say now after discussion today, you say I decided to do computation because my programming is no good. Yeah. Then 2 weeks later, then you can submit because you will finish computation 2 weeks later. Yeah. So that is why we ask you how you obtain this. Don't go into too many detail. Don't go and explain. I use this, blah, 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 blah. Just write a program. Yeah. And you'll be able to find that in 1 second. Yeah. But you need to spend 5 minutes to write your program. Yeah. So 5 minutes plus 1 second, but it's also 5 minutes compared to 2 weeks of effort to manually compute. Okay? So don't go manually compute that which you have, even though we know the formula. Right? Yeah? That is what this question will try to tell you and give you 0.5 marks. Yeah? Right. After you have your expected test and the frequency, so what you have to do now is you will make use of this information, plot it into a graph. Plot into a graph. Yeah? So plot the graph, and then after that, you have to compute the so-called average and the standard deviation. Yeah, so to compute average standard deviation, also their formula. Yeah, so we will go through the formula, and after that, we also have to take note that depending on what you are using Excel to compute for your average and standard deviation. If yes, then you have to be careful because Excel formula is meant or is applicable only for single puzzle. For multiple puzzle, you cannot use Excel formula. Yeah, you have to modify, not say modify, you have to do some formula again. Yeah, to multiply the frequency to compute. Okay, so we'll go through that after that. Yeah, so that's question one. Any question with the question requirement? So you need to do first find what is the number of expected tests, and then find the distribution, frequency distribution, that what are the possible patterns that it can be can exist. Yeah, then you plot them into graph. After you plot them to graph, you will so-called calculate the hex average, the mean, and then you compute the standard deviation. Yeah? Any question? Now, the second one, okay? Since I do not know how to write program. I don't understand. What is this? This is a syllable given to you. Yeah. Which general security principle is violated in the following pseudocode? So modify the pseudocode to fix the potential security problem. So basically, now this pseudocode, yes, it is broken pseudocode. In terms of logic, it makes sense. Yeah. But it has some principle, but a security principle violation. Okay? So you have to identify what is that violation. Then after that, you have to correct it. Yeah? So that this particular, what we call pseudocode works. Okay? Right, so now if you look at the pseudocode, if you get the what we call check the access, the permit, yeah, and then someone or maybe the system say that the permission is access denied, then the pseudocode
I mean, this logic will say that then you access it now, you cannot access. Yeah? Otherwise, they will let you access. That is the pseudo law. Yeah? Now, what happens if you go and check the access? Then the access say that not access denied, but what we call unrecognized, or rather maybe password doesn't match or something like that. Yeah, or maybe access field. We say not access denied, but access field. So when the access field, what will the logic do? It will let you go and access also. Yeah, you say, hey, but your access field, like, yeah, but you are not, it's not denied, so that's why I don't deny it. So mean that this logic is not correct. Yeah? So if the logic is done, that if you, like for example, not sure on whatever that's like, by default, you should reject the request and don't run the. Yeah, don't just simply grant the access if you do not sure. So if you're not sure, reject it. Yeah, because by granting this means what? You give them additional authorization. Yeah, something like that. So in that I can go and find what is that violation, the name of the violation, and then you modify it. Modify this. I don't know how to write program. Don't ask me how to do. Any questions? Yeah, so you have to switch the condition. Yeah? Right. Question number 3. Okay? So this one is give you that the incident of viral attachment in email message is 1 in 800. And then your malware checker will correctly identify a message as a virus. Virus means that this message contains virus. 95% of the time is correct. So meaning that this virus checker is very accurate. 95% is correct. Yeah? And then your malware checker will correctly identify a message as non-viral 95% of the time as well. So meaning that 95% of the time, the virus checker also can tell that, oh, this particular email is clean, attachment is clean, not a virus. So it means that this particular is very, very accurate, yeah, 95%. Now, your malware checker means that now the malware, you receive email with attachment, now the checker say that, oh, this particular message is a virus. Yeah, the checker tells you that this particular message is virus. Right. So now the question, what is the probability that this message is actually not a virus? Yeah. So what is the chance that this message is actually clean? Okay, so ask you to find out. Yeah, so ask you to find using Bayes' theorem, not other theorem, only Bayes' theorem. So you need to use Bayes' theorem to find this, because Bayes' theorem is actually a conditional probability algorithm. That is a formula for you to compute conditional probability. Conditional probability means that I have a situation. The situation says that this is happening. Yeah, so we have a situation. So we have a situation, say, let's say situation is B, and then I want to find what is the probability that it is A. Yeah, it's called conditional probability. We are finding the probability of two related situations. We call condition. Okay, so what is the probability of A with the condition that B has already occurred? Okay, so now it says that the virus, the so-called the checker say that this has virus.
Yeah, mean has virus. So now, what is the probability that if does not have a virus? Yeah, yeah. So that is the probability that you have to calculate. So this one is equal to P B times P A. PA and PA. Probability of BA and probability of A divided by probability of B A not A, probability not A times probability of B A and probability of A. Okay? So we call this the false positive. Yeah, so this is the this is the false positive. Yeah, this is the false positive. So it actually said that it's negative, but you incorrectly say it is positive. Yeah, it's called false positive. Then it's equal to the entire negative. Yeah, this is negative, it's negative, right? PB is negative. So entire negative, the probability of negative, this is the probability of negative over that negative. Yeah, means that this is the false negative. This is the A, this is positive, this is B, and then this is equal to false negative. Okay, over probability of negative. Yeah, it will give you the false positive. Yeah, I mean, if confused on that, you have to then, based on this formula, to just compute what is the probability. Yeah, later on, I give you some examples. Actually, what the question wants you is that, ask you to justify your answer using Bayes' theorem, meaning that now you apply this Bayes' theorem, then you compute. Yeah. Eventually, the probability here is very high, maybe 95% or more. You get the probability. Yeah. So now you say, hey, if my malware is safe that 95% accurate, yeah, 95% accurate, then say that this one is a virus. And you compute, the false positive say that, hey, 97% this particular email is clean. So now who you trust? You trust the malware or you trust this calculation? Huh? If you trust the calculation, you say 97, but then why my malware say, virus. The malware said virus. Yeah. The malware said virus. And the malware is 95% correct. Yeah? So now you get 10 email come in. 9.5 times it will tell you correctly. Okay? So now this time tells you that this email has virus. Okay? So but according to this formula it compute, it says that 95% or more. This email is clean. So now which one you try? Your malware or this formula? Formula. Then your malware is accurate. By 95%. Yeah? So you have to justify why there is such a thing. That you have to justify your answer. So you have to explain why there is a conflict in this. Any questions? Yeah. So later we'll go through example and then we'll see how you can justify. Yeah. Now, question 4. You have to go and do or talk to Uncle Google, yes, or your auntie YouTube or whoever. Describe your in your own word a specific instance of an insider placing malware within the system. So you should describe the type of malware placed the expected likely impact and some detail regarding the outcome. Okay, so this is not a hypothetical scenario you have to make up, but you need to find an actual real world example. Yeah, so what you have to do is now you have to go and search in the internet, is there any case or incident where insider release malware to the system? Yeah, so this case, it can be intentional, it can be unintentional, meaning that someone not happy, so they intentionally put malware inside the system. Yeah, so this person is what we call a legitimate person. Okay, we call misfeasor. Means that he is a person who has a user ID, he has a password and so on. He can log into the system because he's working there. Yeah, so now, but once he log in, he released malware. And then what happened? That means what will be the so-called, what type of malware is this? And then what happened? And then, what is the outcome? So you have to go and find such a case and explain. Okay? Yeah? Now, for this case, it is not hypothetical. You need to find and then you need to provide reference. So when I do the marking, I go to the reference and I cannot see anything related to what you say. No mark, huh? I must find the source or go to the source and say, hey, yeah, there is this and that. Then you get mark. If you don't, then no mark for that. Yeah, so you need to provide references. Yeah. Right, then question 5. Okay, question 5 is that every hour, okay, the worm spread. Okay, so this one, this question is easy. No, yeah, it's easy lah. Basically, it's easy. But a bit tedious, yeah, and you have to be alert, yeah. Now it says every hour a worm X spread from each infected computer to previously uninfected computer in answering this question, you should explain how you determine your answer. Okay, so we now say that we have a worm X, and this X, this worm can spread from one computer to another computer, okay, for every hour. So one computer, you can spread another computer in 1 hour. Yeah. Now, given the table show the number of infected computers each hour across 24-hour period, at time zero, the X is, the number of X infected computers is 1. So now, you say that at time zero, that is 1, x equal to 1. That 1 hour later, we will infect another computer. So now x become 2. Yeah. 1 hour later, we become how many?
4.
16, 32, and so on. For so, you have to do until T23. Yeah. Yeah, like 0. You start from 0 to 23. 24 hours. Whatever. After that, you plot the graph. This one is okay, right? 2 to power 0, 2 to power 1, 2 to power 2, 2 to power 3, all together 2 to power 23. So all together 24 hours. Yeah. 24 hours time, huh? So you plot the graph. It's easy. Yeah, easy. Yeah. So now for the second one, when x what we call W. Okay, so we have x here and we have W. Same, you start from T0, x come in. Yeah? At T1, x is 2. Yeah? At T2, x is 4. At T3, x is 8. And then T4, 16. 32 and continue, yeah, until to about 23, that is whatever, yeah. So now assuming that instead of what we call 6.5, I say that maybe at here, W comes in. This is the 3.5. W come in. Yeah, W comes in. So W is introduced. So this W introduced, it will actually clean one of the virus. One of the computer. Yeah. Now if W comes in, what will be the number of X in T4? Will it be 16? It cannot be 16 anymore. Yeah? It had to be 14. Not 16. Yeah? You get me? Because now when this comes in, it clean one. So now it's not 8 infected computer, it's only 7 infected computer. Right? So next hour it will double, become 2 times 7, not 2 times 8. Yes? Yeah? Now this one, at T3 or 4.5, what will be the W here? Three. Yeah. So when W is 3, then this one is how many?
32.
Beta B,
9.
No, I mean this one.
32 minus
30. 32 minus?
50.
Yes, okay. Because this one of them is reduced. That means that the other two computers will clean another two. So that means it need to reduce another 4. So this one is 28, not 32. Right. Okay. Because every 1 hour from 1 become 3, right? It will clean another 2. So when it comes in, it reduce 1. To become 14. Yeah? Now, when it increases another 2, so that 2 will remove 2 of these. Correct? And then now from here, this is no longer 12. I mean 14, this one is actually 12 only, right? And then, then 24. Yeah? Yeah? So it, then it becomes 40, 24, not multiply of this 14. Yeah? Yeah, so you have to continue. Yeah, because, yeah, this one increased to 14, right? But during this time, the W will clean another 2. So now, become only 12 infected, not 14 infected. Yeah? then this one, this become 12 times 2, so it's 24, not 28. Yeah? So you have to be careful on that. So then you, okay. Yeah? So now, these two value X and W, after you computed the value already, you use this to plot the graph. Two together. Yeah? So now you have two lines, and then, yeah, you see what happens. Yeah? That means since the introduction of W, your this, the growth rate of your X is slower than W. Yeah? Growth rate is slower than W. So meaning that somewhere here, I do not know where, but somewhere here, your X will become zero. Yeah? So now the that is yes. One more. Okay. So now if let's say this one is when this one is 14, this will at this point of the time it will actually somewhere here this will this the at this point of the time one come in will clear one, right? So somewhere here it will clear another two. Yeah, so that means this is now 12, not 14. Yeah, so meaning that at this point of the time, T1, T2, T4, this is T5. So at T5, yeah, so this one, it will clear become 12. Huh? So at T5, it will now become 24. Because each one of these infect another one. Is it correct?
Six.
You have to put in the find the formula somewhere here, then we have 3. Then yeah, somewhere here it will be clean. So in the sense that from 8 here, right, at T3, T3.5, the W introduced, it will clean from 8 become 7 computer. Yeah? So 7 computer, it will now mean that double becomes 14 infected. Yeah? And then because the worm, it can actually clean 2 in every 1 hour. So the mean in this hour, it actually have 3 computer clean already. 3 W, not 3 computer, but 3 W in the computer. So meaning that it will actually additional 2 coming in, right? Original 1, then another 2 coming in. Yeah, because that is W, so itself, and then new W and new W. So these are the 2 new 1. Yeah.
It's not 14, right? It's minus
6, right?
Not minus 9. Because
3
already.
Yeah, 3 already there. Yeah.
Minus 6.
So that means these two, will take away from these two. So now you have 12. Yeah, so 12, it will increase to 24. And then from here, 3, I introduce another, each one introduce another 2. So now I have introduced another 6 more coming in. Yeah, so now 24, it will become 24 minus 6. Yeah, and then you double from there. Yeah, then this one 327. So now in this case, 9 has been cleared before, and then whatever, then you minus. Yeah, continue to do that. So somewhere here, it will become 0 because W spread faster or clean faster than the X. Yeah. So you have to think of the formula and yeah, plot it properly. It is a bit tedious, yeah, but you just be alert how the formula, once you get one formula work, then subsequently all the same already if you use Excel. Yeah? Now then you have to plot the two cases together. Indicate when the end will become green. Yeah? Somewhere there. Okay. Yes. Now, number D, yeah? Then you have to add in the new condition. Say that at time 9, X evolves to spread to 3. Now X is not 1 to 1, it's 1 and then spread to another 3. Yeah, so now your X will now spread faster than W. Okay, so then ask you to compute for each hour what happened.
otherwise
how you show how the thing happens in D. That means this D is a combination of A, B and C. That means you A start from 0, right? Then W comes in at 6.5, okay. Right? And then at 9, the X change. Okay. Right? So your graph will change a bit. Okay. I mean, of course, you can agree, okay, but the question didn't ask me to put the graph. So you don't put a graph, then you have to write long story to explain. Now, if you put graph, you can use the graph and then.
Can you use the table thing with you?
Again. But you have to explain that paper, how the figure changes. You still have to move, but you have blanks to write.
14.5, is it my time line?
Yeah, going on, it's so much.
Yeah? Now, question 6 is again, have to talk to Uncle Google. Yeah? But when you write, same, you have to provide the references. Have to provide the references, and briefly describe in your own word each of the following visuals to describe the domain and nature. So, what is domain? So now we have to go and see. Oh, what is actually an HTML form? So now, when you write, you don't say, just copy and paste or whatever. Then you have to see. HTML form from the behavior of description is actually a worm or a virus or Trojan horse and whatever. Yeah. Then the nature is, yeah. You how do you know that as well? So you based on the way it spread.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. or maybe say, oh, this one is actually denial service, right? So denial service under what?
Trojan.
Right. Because the thing, he won't tell you that this is Trojan horse or whatever. Maybe some article may tell you, but some may not. It also depends on where you get the source. Okay? So now, if you based on the behavior, then the nature, then you know, oh, actually, this one is what. Then, based on the way it spread, based on the way it released the payload, based on the way this malware infected the system and so forth, the outcome and so forth. So, this one have the behavior of what we call maybe a Trojan horse. Yeah? And the outcome is a denial service or something like that. The you just, briefly explain that.
So,
how the thing, the domain is of course whether it is a virus, whether it is a worm, whether it is a Trojan horse. Yeah? But whether it is virus, Trojan horse or whatever, you have to based on the nature. That means you have to read, oh, this particular malware, how it spread, how it released the payload, what activity it does, it maybe open backdoor or crash your system or steal information or modify your whatever registry, something like that. Then you will be able to now classify whether it is a Trojan horse or whether it is a virus or whether it is a, what we call worm. Okay? Any question? Right. So now when you do this, okay, maybe from here you know the nature, know the domain and so forth. So you have to be careful now in the way the agent may be. I do not know. As I told you, Dr. Yong. Dr. Yong. It's called Dr. Yong. I may call it Yong. No, Yong. Okay. So Yong. Okay. So he did not tell me for example. We will over here, we will do the exam and assignment similar to this Pomingyang from Pomingyang. But he did not. Yeah? So I do not know how he's going to do the exam. Yeah? So I do not know. But from the assignment, it seems like more or less following the same format of structure. Okay, so hopefully he follows the same. I follow the same, then I remember during this year we have a little bit of an incident. Inside that, in the exam, that was many years back. The exam asked describe or something like what is ransomware. Then the student complained. Where do we discuss ransomware in lecture? If that time is new things are out, right? You say you never discuss and so on and so forth. And then why you ask in the question? Then you say, ransomware is malware, we discuss malware, so you should know what is it based on the features, based on the behavior, you think you should know. So it doesn't mean that every new malware we must discuss first, then we can ask it in that sense. You get what I mean? So meaning that he can ask anything that you may not see in the lecture related to malware, and then you cannot complain. We don't discuss this in lecture. Why you ask me?
So you went through.
I mean, it's 1 mark but it still make noise
Yeah.
One mark DNA.
So meaning that, well, when you do this research and so on, in the event that you go to a site where you describe all these things, you manage to find other things as well. So be just know what are they and so on, so you'll be good. The comedian say that, hey, but this is malware, we discuss malware, you should know the behavior, right? So now that we don't go and discuss what ransomware is, but from these people, whatever, you know what was your bad, and then you should know that it is a virus, or if it's a worm, or if it's a student house. Okay. Good. No question, then we will look at the material first, related to the assignment. How does a probability distribution differ from a frequency distribution?
So what is a probability distribution and what is a frequency distribution?
Okay, so the frequency distribution is actually what we call the graph or the chart that